before, but what does that mean to have that type of exposure, to have that type of headline coming almost at the right time for you?
Yeah, no, it's amazing. You know, I'm this will be my second main event. You know, I was the main event 4 years ago in Orlando, and yeah, it's perfect timing. You know, I wouldn't have it any other way. I'm fighting a tough opponent, Calvin Kattar, and I feel like this is a title eliminator. You know what I mean? He's ranked fourth in the world. I'm currently seventh, and the guys that are second and third, they're fighting each other. They both lost to the champion and the number one contender. So it's great to get the exposure, the recognition, and man, I'm just gonna go out there and I'm gonna do everything that I need to do, everything possible to just get my hand raised. You know, I don't care where the fight goes, I'll be prepared, and you know, I'll go for a whole 25 minutes, whether it's a sprint, wherever we end up, I'm gonna get the job done, get the win, and then figure out what's next.
Well said. I mean, I know everyone's already looking at this fight for the featherweight. They're looking at July 2nd for what Volkanovski does. Mm-hmm. Does it kind of feel like stars are aligning a little bit here for you?
Oh, 100%. You know, I feel like everything's kind of aligning. You know, like the stars are aligning. Like if I could write this perfect, I go out there, have a spectacular performance. Get a big finish against Calvin Kattar. 2 weeks later, I'm sitting cage side in Vegas, seeing who I'm fighting for the title.
Wow. What's it been like since your last fight with Dan Ige to this moment now?
Yeah, since the last fight, you know, it's everything's been great. You know, my knee's back to 100%. Before that fight, it definitely wasn't. I was telling everyone I was good, but you know, I hadn't fought in 18 months. So I was getting to the fight. A goal of mine was to fight in 2021 because I fought every single year. And even though I got to like the very end of 2021, I still, you know, achieved one of my goals. And, you know, I just feel good for this fight. That's all I can say. I'm back to 100% training, like doing everything that got me to the big show, and fights that, you know, I'm just doing everything that I kind of screwed that
okay.
up. Yeah. I'm just back to 100% of training that got me back to, or got me to the big show, and got me on like just my win streak. You know, I had to manipulate training and just with the ACL injury and surgery, my knee was, man, I don't even know, like 50%. It hurt to walk down steps. It hurt to walk off a curb. And then I want to say like 2 months after the Ige fight, I was lifting with my strength coach and I was just like, man, my knee doesn't hurt anymore. Like all of a sudden I just took a turn for the better. And man, I'm excited for this fight. You know, it's a tough, tough test, but you know, I'm so prepared, and I feel like just everything has led me to this moment. You know, everything in my life, everything in my career, I literally wouldn't want it any other way, because without all like that obstacles and all the adversity that I've went through and experienced in my career and personally, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for all that. So I'm ready to rock.
Do you get used to people kind of looking at you like a medical marvel? Like, I mean, I remember talking to you, and my eyes must have looked incredibly wide, which for me is saying something because they're kind of small. But like, just I looked at you, I was like, I can't believe what you had gone through, what you put yourself through, and here you are going to fight again. That journey alone, going into that fight, I know it's kind of in the rear view now, but does it even impress yourself of what you went through at this point?
Man, not really, but a lot of people I talk to, you know, they're like, this guy's like the bionic man, this guy, like, they're just amazed of like how many injuries, like, and they're serious injuries that I've sustained and suffered, and all these surgeries I've gone through, literally from like head to toe, you know. But no, and like for myself, looking out at it, I guess it's, I don't think about it too much, but from the outside, a lot of people do talk about that. But I've always said, you know, I want to give people hope. I want to inspire people. And I do get a lot of messages that, you know, I help someone get through cancer. I help them get through this, because they're like, I see what you've gone through and I think of you. And it just motivates them in whatever situation that they have going on. So it's amazing to get those type of you know, messages and things like that. But at the end of the day, they're doing the work. It's not me. But if I can inspire someone, I'm you know, I'm all about it.
You mentioned Bionic Man. I think the funniest thing I saw was somebody put, they superimposed your head on Arnold Schwarzenegger for the Terminator on the bike with the glasses.
Oh, that's like,
I mean, it's just really kind of a testament to what you've been through in your journey. Mm.
Yeah. I didn't see that one, but I've seen a lot of different things, and it is cool, but that's my mindset. You know, I'm either it's all gonna pay off. You know, I'm either it's very stupid, or I'm just, you know, my mindset is on another level. Like I set out to get in the UFC, I set out to be a world champion, and I'm so close. You know, I literally have one person in front of me, and my sole focus is on Calvin Kattar on June 18th. But once I get my hand raised and I get that big win, and then I'll start looking what's next, but I have to get my hand raised, otherwise this all means nothing.
I'm gonna get to that again in 1 second, but I wanna look back at that Ige fight, because I imagine there's things you learn about yourself every step of the way. Is there anything that stands out from that fight that you took away from that maybe you learned about yourself that you didn't know?
Yeah, from the Ige fight, not necessarily. I didn't learn a whole lot. It was just my knee wasn't there. You know, I didn't wrestle, I didn't grapple, I didn't run for that fight. I was just like hitting mitts and doing stand-up fighting and lifting and doing what I could to be in tip-top shape. I was more hesitant, I guess you could say, in that fight, just because I knew they were going to target the knee. But yeah, I'm glad that it went the full 15 minutes, because I dropped him in the first minute. And if I would have, you know, got on top of him and got the TKO, then I still would it would still be in my head possibly, like, is my knee okay, you know? But I went a full 15 minutes with a tough guy, and Ige is, man, he doesn't get the respect he deserves. Like, he's, you know, he's a tough Hawaiian dude that likes to scrap, and he took a hard shots, and he was in the fight the whole time, and he was throwing heavy leather, and you know, I nothing but respect to the guy, but I'm just glad that I got more ring time in that December fight, just because I know that my knee is 100%. And then, like I said, you know, 2 months after that fight, everything just clicked, and then my knee, I feel springy again. It's like there's no pain in it. So
that's awesome. How did this fight kind of come to fruition? I mean, did you think that Calvin would be your next fight, or did you kind of maybe think it might take a different path?
Yeah, so I wanted to fight. You know, I wanted to stay active, just because I had, I felt good after that fight I had in December. So I almost got a fight against Max Holloway in the end of March, but things just didn't materialize. And then I thought I was going to fight the end of April, and then the end of May, or the beginning of May. But then none of these fights were coming together. And so I know with the division and everything, I was like, I'm gonna have to fight someone behind me. And I guess I was okay with that, because I wanted to stay active. I wanted to fight. And then all of a sudden I got the call from my manager, and he's like, hey, they want you to be the main event against Calvin Kattar. And I was like, let's do it. You know, it's like, I can't say no to that. And just like you said, with all the exposure and stuff, this is a big card on ESPN. So it's gonna be simulcast on ESPN Plus and ESPN, and I really feel like I go out there and I get a huge win, then I'm going to get that push from the UFC and make my run at the title.
When you're waiting for your next fight, I know, you know, there's so many factors that come into it. How much of it is just waiting on someone else to give you the opportunity versus you saying, no, I want this? Because you hear so many fighters, including yourself, I know, just campaigning for certain fights and certain tests. What's that process like?
Yeah, it's tough, you know, especially like as you get to the top of the division, you know, there's only a handful of people in front of me in the world. So it's like, if they're booked, I know I'm not fighting them. It's like, I want these fights, but I try to stay in the gym. I try to stay active. It's a long process, you know what I mean? I'm grateful that Calvin took this fight, because he's fighting behind. You know, he's ranked fourth in the world, but he knows that Volkanovski and Holloway are fighting for the title July 2nd, and then the other two guys in front of him are fighting. So, you know, I feel like I'm on a four-fight win streak. He's coming off a great performance against Giga. And, I knew it was just bound to happen. And like you said, the stars just aligned, and this is, like, the fight that needs to happen in order to get that number one contender spot.
This may be a corny question, but it's kind of just curious. Is it almost a blessing that the Holloway fight didn't happen based on the way things kind of work with shake out? I mean, this one seems to be the next step. This will be the one to fight whoever wins July. The winner of this fights the winner of July 2nd, right? Mm-hmm. Is that almost a blessing in disguise that it kind of worked this way?
Yeah, 100%. You know, like, I want to fight the best. I feel like I'm the best featherweight on this planet. But I was going to fight Max Holloway, arguably one of the best featherweights of all time, on a three-week notice. You know, I said yes to it, but for whatever happened, it just didn't come together. So it is a blessing in disguise. So I've been in the gym since February, just training, and then I got a seven-week notice for the Kattar fight. And so I, like I said, I wouldn't have done any other way, because he is such a big name, and people, they want to see us fight. You know, that it's entertainment, and this sure is going to be an entertaining fight for them.
Yeah. When you look at, do you think there's a little bit of reward? For example, it's a fight game. Things happen. Short fight, like you said, 3 week notice. Maybe not ideal, but you got to take it. It's a tremendous opportunity. Mm-hmm. It didn't come through. Do you think there's a little bit of a reward factor the UFC looks at and go, he was willing to take this fight. Mm-hmm. We have to reward him this way, even though it made sense.
Yeah, no, I agree. You know, I feel like there is a little bit of a reward. I've never said no to a fight. Any fight that Sean Shelby's ever offered me, or Joe Silva back in the day, I've said yes. You know, and there's, so that's the reward. They like me because I'm easy to work with. They already know the answer. You know, they tell my manager, he calls me, and I'm like, within 30 minutes, I'm like, let's do it. You know what I mean? Whether they're ranked behind me, whether they're ranked in front of me, it's a big opportunity, short notice. I'm willing to, you know, to take that risk, you know, because big risk, you know, equals big reward. And, you know, I'm all about that. I'll never pass up on an opportunity. And I think they did reward me for always saying yes, for always accepting the fights that they offer me, and never turning anything down. So I literally feel like this is our time, you know. And I say that with, you know, all my coaches, my wife, my family, friends, like fans, supporters, like therapists, doctors, like dietitians, mind coach, everybody. Like, this is our time. I have the best support system behind me, and everyone's put in so much. They've invested so much into me and given me so much time, and I'm going to go out there, and I won't forget all their support, and it just fuels me, you know. It really fuels me and motivates the hell out of me to get a big win and then just make everyone proud.
That's awesome. I want to talk about the opponent. I know we touched a little bit upon it, but maybe a little more in depth here. What do you need to know about Calvin Kattar when you step in the octagon against him?
Man, I just have to perform. You know, I haven't changed up any of my training. Basically, like I said, I'm just doing everything that got me to the big show. And he's a tough fighter. You know, he's predominantly a stand-up fighter. He has great Muay Thai, good boxing. I know he's going to be coming with those elbows and knees. So I just have to show up. You know, the best me shows up, no one in the world can beat me. And I feel like I'm faster, I'm more powerful. I feel like I'm a better wrestler, grappler. I even feel in all these aspects of martial arts, whether we just box, we wrestle, we do jiu-jitsu, I feel like I beat him everywhere. So I literally just have to go in there, implement my game plan, and just stay sharp one round at a time, potentially for five rounds, you know, 25 minutes of fighting. I just have to stay sharp one round at a time, and I'll get my hand raised.
I know I screwed that up, and I said it was your first headlining fight. I forgot about the other one, so thank you for telling me that, because all these end up blending together, unfortunately, for me. But is there anything like being a headliner as opposed to being lower on the card, where does the mindset change at all? Does the pressures and the kind of your attention, and there's so many distractions pulled to you? How do you kind of reconcile the two a little bit as you go into fight week?
Yeah, no, it's definitely... I'll say being a main event, it's just more media obligations. So I am being pulled in all directions, a lot more interviews leading up to the fight. But, you know, this Saturday is like I have a big interview, and then next week I'm not going to do any more stuff until, of course, fight week. Then it's like I have so much obligations. But that's the only thing that kind of is different, which, you know, I don't even know where I'm going with that. I don't know.
That works.
I don't know.
No, you're good. Two things I wanted to touch on. You're getting, so many people are talking about you again, which is great, because, you know, you're on this winning streak. It dates back a little bit before the injury, but you showed that you were still that same fighter. Does that encourage you even anymore that maybe people hadn't forgotten about you? Because when you're away from the game, it seems like the game keeps going on, right?
Yeah, no doubt. Especially in the UFC, the UFC moves so fast, what I mean? So it's like they have fights every week. So when you're hot and you have all this momentum, you have to ride that wave. You have to, kind of stay in the limelight and get these big fights, for people to remember who you are or they forget about you. But when I was out with my ACL injury for that whole year, even a year and a half, no matter who fought, it was, featherweights would fight. It doesn't matter if they're both making their debuts. I was like, watch this. The winner, people are going to start saying they need to fight me. I was like, so at least my name was still in discussion like the whole time, I was out. And, I guess it doesn't make a difference to me, but I guess it was nice that like, my name's still being talked about, even though I was out for so long. And, I had a huge performance in December, and then this is going to be a huge, huge fight. So I get the job done. It's like, I'm going to hop on that wave and ride it all the way to the featherweight title.
Just picking up on that, it's one thing to hear your name bandied about with media and fans. Another one would have other fighters, opponents, your peers. Jeremy Stephens is one of them. He's been just saying so many unbelievable things about you as you kind of go on your journey here and you're on the street. What does that kind of do for you as you go forward, knowing that it's somebody in your past that you fought, a pretty big name in this sport, who's just, hyping you up and talking you up so much?
Yeah, no, I've heard Stevens talk about me. I've heard some of the stuff in the articles, and nothing but good things. Like I always said, given the circumstances and some of the controversy behind that fight, I'm not mad, but I know a lot of like my family and friends and teammates are, they were upset about it. But, I learned from that fight. That's all I can say. You know what I mean? I learned a lot from that fight. I was winning that fight. I dropped Stevens, and I should have done what he did to me in the second, and that's why I'm never going to let that happen again. I get someone hurt, I'm going to keep them hurt and going for the finish. I'm always in great shape. And but it is cool, to hear him, give me praise. And he's been saying it for years since we fought, and I've come back from all those injuries, and I've continued to win and knock people out. He's like, that guy's going to be a world champion. And he was saying, like, I was one of his toughest fights, too, And even though it only went two rounds, but, I wished him luck in his PFL debut. I think he can still go for the $1 million, but he had a tough or close loss, decision, unfortunately not on his side, but it's kind of cool,
I say that because, you yourself call out Alexander Volkanovski the GOAT, and there's a possibility of you fighting him if everything goes well in your fight, everything goes well with him in his fight.
Yep.
What would that kind of opportunity mean to you?
No, it'd mean everything to fight for the title, but it's like I can't overlook Calvin Kattar. He's in front of me, and all my focus is strictly on him. But I believe whoever is the champion is the best. And Volkanovski, he's on some crazy like 22 or 23 fight win streak. He's undefeated in the UFC. He's beat some of the GOATs in the featherweight division. He beat Jose Aldo. He beat Max Holloway twice, even though I know the second fight was super close and controversial, but they're about to run it back for the third time. And if he beats him again, then that kind of solidifies that. Like, I feel like he is the greatest of all time at this moment. When we meet, then there's going to be a new king in town. And I think him and I stylistically match up the best. He has the blueprint to beat a lot of these guys that have the body style of Max Holloway, So he's done that several times, but he hasn't fought anybody like me, The closest person to like my style and power would be my teammate and Fred Chad Mendez, So I just think it'd be a great fight, and the fans want to see it, but I have to get through Calvin Kattar first.
Final question, does Calvin compare similarly to anything you've fought before?
Think about it. I feel like a lot of people, he's similar to a lot of previous opponents I've fought. I haven't really thought about it too much, but he's tall. He's skinny, you know what I mean? He's 5'11". So I fought guys. I was fighting at 155 on the regional scene, my first three fights in the UFC. So, you know, his body type is like John Tuck, Michael Johnson, just not a southpaw, Desmond Green, Christos Yagos, and probably some other people I fought on the regional scene. So yeah, he's a great striker. He's tall, skinny, and long. But I feel like I possess a different type of power, and I feel that I just have to get inside, into a little bit of danger, and just work his body, and it'll set up the big shots upstairs and implement everything. You know, I come from a wrestling background. I can go anywhere in this fight, and people forget about that. They don't even know that I, because if you watch any of my UFC fights, I don't wrestle anyone. I can do it all. So I just have to go out there and be a mixed martial artist. And like I said, just stay in the present, stay calm, and just take it one round at a time.